Take one, pick why. One that I want to pick is because we've got a baptism this morning for Miles Ray Lipp, son of Angela and Casey Lipp, who are Gary and, well, Angela's Gary and Jean's. Casey, I guess now you are too, right? Yeah. So, but there's also communion this morning, which is Jesus coming to us, right? His body and blood coming to us for the forgiveness of our sins. And there's lots of wonderful people here this morning, which is awesome. It's great to see you all here, gathered around God's word, which is for you, for your salvation, which we'll hear about as it was for Zacchaeus and his life as he heard it, as God came to him and talked about how salvation was his. Also, we are celebrating Reformation Sunday today. If you notice, the colors have changed, so we'll have a little bit of celebration about that. But if you want more Reformation, if you don't get your Reformation fill here today, 6:30 p.m. over at Emmanuel and Parker's, there will be a Reformation service, which will be a joy as well. So there's that available for you. So with all the things to be able to celebrate today, why don't we celebrate together as we stand and we sing our opening hymn, Father Welcomes. We begin in the name of our baptisms as we begin also in the name of Miles' soon-to-be baptism. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Dearly beloved, Christ our Lord says in Matthew chapter 28, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit." And in the last chapter of Mark, our Lord promises, "Whoever believes and is baptized shall be saved." And the Apostle Peter writes, baptism now saves you. So we say together, it's by Scripture, that God works a mighty and mysterious miracle in baptism for all who believe. The Word of God also teaches us that we are all conceived and born sinful and are under the power of the devil until Christ claims us as his own. We would be lost forever unless delivered from sin, death, and everlasting condemnation. And so the Father of all mercy and grace has sent his Son, Jesus Christ, who atoned for the sin of the whole world, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. And how is this child to be named? Miles Ray Lipp, I receive the sign of the cross both upon your forehead and upon your heart to mark you as one redeemed by Christ crucified and risen. Let us pray. Almighty and eternal God, according to your strict judgment, you condemned the unbelieving world through the flood. Yet according to your great mercy, you preserved believing Noah and his family, 8 souls in all. You drowned hard-hearted Pharaoh and all his host in the Red Sea, yet led your people Israel through the water on dry ground, foreshadowing the washing of your holy baptism. Through the baptism in the Jordan of your beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, you sanctified and instituted all waters to be a blessed flood and a lavish washing away of sin. We pray that you would behold Miles according to your boundless mercy and bless him with true faith by the Holy Spirit, that through this saving flood, all sin in him which has been inherited from Adam and which he himself has committed since would be drowned and die. Grant that he be kept safe and secure in the holy ark of the Christian church, and being separated from the multitude of unbelievers, serves your name at all times with a fervent spirit and a joyful hope, so that with all believers in your promise, he would be declared worthy of eternal life. Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. From ancient times, the church has observed the custom of appointing sponsors for baptismal candidates and catechumens. In the Evangelical Lutheran Church, sponsors are to confess the faith expressed in the Apostles' Creed and taught in the Small Catechism. They are, whenever possible, as is today, to witness the baptism of their sponsor. They are to pray for them, support them in their ongoing instruction and nurture in the Christian faith, and encourage them towards a faithful reception of the Lord's Supper. They are at all times to be examples to them of the holy life of faith in Christ and love for their neighbor. And so I ask you three, is it your intention to serve Miles as sponsors of the Christian faith? If so, say yes with the help of God. God enable each of you to will and to do this faithful and loving work, and with his grace, fulfill what we are unable to do. Hear the Holy Gospel according to St. Mark. They brought young children to Jesus that he might touch them, but the disciples rebuked those who brought them. But when Jesus saw it, he was greatly displeased and said to them, "Let the little children come to me, and do not forbid them, for such is the kingdom of God. Assuredly, I say to you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will by no means enter it." And he took them up in his arms, and he put his hands on them, and he blessed them, so that as God's people, we would bless Miles by praying over him the prayer our Lord has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Because Miles is not able to answer for himself, we shall all speak together with sponsors and parents faithfully on his behalf in testimony of this forgiveness of sin and birth of this life of faith, which God our Father bestows on him through baptism. So I ask all of you, do you renounce the devil and all his works and all his ways? Do you believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth?
Yes, I believe.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried? He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again from the dead, and he ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. And from thence he will come to judge the living and the dead? Do you believe in the Holy Spirit, the holy Christian church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting?
Yes, I believe.
At this time, children, if you want to come forward and stand right over here, you're welcome to come forward and see the baptism of Miles at this time. I'd love for you to come forward at this time. Come on right over here so you guys can all see. And if you're a big kid, if you would just sit down so the littler kids can see too. Come on up here, everyone. Come on up, buddy. Because what we're going to see right now is that Miles is going to get baptized. And this is just regular old water, right? Yeah. Remember last month we talked a little bit about baptism? You can come up with your parents, buddy. Miles is going to get baptized here in to God's family, which you are all a part of as well. And so I'm going to say some words, but it's not anything special that I do. What you get to see here is God coming into the life of Miles. And he's going to make him a new creature, and he's going to live out his life in faith towards God, because God forgives him all his sins. Are you guys ready to watch that happen? Yeah, okay, great. Man, you're so light. Miles, Ray, Lip, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. The Almighty God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has given you new birth of water and of the Spirit, forgive you all your sins, strengthen you with his grace to life everlasting. Receive this white garment to show you that Miles has been clothed with the robe of Christ's righteousness that covers all his sin till the day he dies. He will stand without judgment, without fear, before the judgment seat of Christ to receive the inheritance prepared for him from the foundation of the world. And also receive this burning light to show you and to show Miles, to remind him on the day of his baptism, when you remember it next year and you tell him that on October 30th he was brought into God's family, you can remind him that he has the light of Christ, which is the light of the world. That he will live always in the light of Christ and help him to ever be watchful for his coming, that he may meet him and enter into his kingdom with joy. We continue with the next part of the service, and so let us join together in prayer as we stand together. In holy baptism, God the Father has made Miles a member of his Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, and an heir with us of all the treasures of heaven in the one holy Christian and apostolic church. We receive him in Jesus' name as our brother in Christ, that together we might hear his word, receive his gifts, and proclaim the praises of him who called all of us out of darkness into his marvelous light. Amen. We welcome you in the name of the Lord. Let us pray. Almighty and merciful God and Father, we thank and praise you that you graciously preserve and enlarge your family and have granted Miles the new birth in holy baptism and made him a member of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, and an heir of your heavenly kingdom. We humbly implore you that as he now has become your child, you would keep him in his baptismal grace, that according to your good pleasure he may faithfully grow to lead a godly life to the praise and honor of your holy name. And finally, with all your saints, obtain the promised inheritance in heaven through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let's welcome Miles with a round of applause. Welcome, buddy. You may be seated and you may return to your seats. Actually, remain standing because we're going to have a time of confession. But you can return to your seats, kids. And congratulations. And this is for you as well.
Thank you.
Yeah. It's so great to have a baptism, right? And to see Miles' sins washed away, we also begin our time together with a time of confession. And in that time of confession, we continue with a moment of silence to reflect on the meaning of God's doing of his work in our own lives in calling us to repentance. So let us begin with a moment of silence. Enter into my heart, O Lord, and cleanse me of my sin. By what I have thought, by what I have done,
I deserve to be cast from your presence.
And yet, in your mercy, your spirit remains with me, O Lord.
Redeem me.
Restore me.
Renew me.
Though my sins are as scarlet, you, O Lord, have sought me. We gather in our Heavenly Father's house that we may receive the cleansing grace of Jesus and the renewal of his Holy Spirit. In the Lord Jesus Christ, crucified and risen and coming again, there is life and salvation for all who believe. In his stead and by his command, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Let us join together in a hymn of praise together. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O Lord, stir up the heavens of your faithful people to welcome and joyfully receive your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, that he may find in us a fit dwelling place, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
You may be seated. Our Old Testament reading today comes from Isaiah chapter 1, verses 10 through 18. And here God commands his people to remove their evil, the evil of their ways, and promises cleansing from their sin. Hear the word of the Lord, you rulers of Sodom. Listen to the law of our God, you people of Gomorrah. The multitude of your sacrifices, what are they to me, says the Lord? I have more than enough burnt offerings of rams and the fat of fatted animals. I have no pleasure in the blood of bulls and lambs and goats. When you come to appear before me, who has asked this of you, this trampling of my courts? Stop bringing meaningless offerings. Your incense is detestable to me. New moons and Sabbaths and convocations, I cannot bear your evil assemblies. Your new moon festivals and your appointed feasts, my soul hates. They have become a burden to me. I am weary of bearing them. When you spread out your hands in prayer, I will hide my eyes from you. Even if you offer many prayers, I will not listen. Your hands are full of blood. Wash and make yourselves clean. Take your evil deeds out of my sight. Stop doing wrong. Learn to do right. Seek justice. Encourage the oppressed. Defend the cause of the fatherless. Plead the case of the widow. Come, now, let us reason together, says the Lord. Though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be white as snow. Though they are red as crimson, they shall be like wool. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Our epistle reading today is from 2 Thessalonians, verses 1 through 5 and 11 through 12. God makes us worthy of his calling and fulfills every work of faith for the glory of Jesus. Paul, Silas, and Timothy, to the church of the Thessalonians in God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, grace and peace to you from God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. We ought always to thank God for you, brothers, and rightly so, because your faith is growing more and more, and the love every one of you has for each other is increasing. Therefore, among God's churches, we boast about your perseverance and faith and all the persecutions and trials you are enduring. All this is evidence that God's judgment is right, and as a result, you will be counted worthy of the kingdom of God for which you are suffering. With this in mind, we constantly pray for you, that our God may count you worthy of his calling, and that by his power he may fulfill every good purpose of yours and every act prompted by your faith. We pray this so that the name of our Lord Jesus may be glorified in you and you in him, according to the grace of our God and the Lord Jesus Christ. This is the word of our Lord.
Stand as you are able, out of reverence for the life and ministry of Jesus Christ. As Jesus seeks and saves the lost, he brings salvation to the house and heart of Zacchaeus. The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 19th chapter. Jesus entered Jericho, and he was passing through. A man was there by the name of Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector and was wealthy. He wanted to see who Jesus was, but being a short man, he could not because of the crowd. So he ran and climbed a sycamore fig tree to see him since Jesus was coming that way. While Jesus reached the spot, he looked up and said to him, "Zacchaeus, come down immediately. I must stay at your house today." So he came down at once and welcomed him gladly. All the people saw this and began to mutter, "He has gone to be the guest of a sinner." But Zacchaeus stood up and said to the Lord, "Look, Lord, here and now I give half of my possessions to the poor. And if I have cheated anybody out of anything, I will pay back four times the amount." Jesus said to him, "Today, salvation has come to this house, because this man too is the son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek and to save what was lost." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated as we sing our hymn of the day, which may be a new hymn to some of us. So if you would like to grab your hymnals in the front part of your pew and open up to page 594, you can find the lyrics and the words there, and also the tune as well, but they'll also be up on the screen as we sing this wonderful baptismal hymn together. treasures many. I have one worth more than any. Be salvation free, lasting to eternity. Sin disturb my soul no longer. I am baptized into Christ. I have comfort even stronger, Jesus' cleansing sacrifice. Should a guilty conscience seize me, since my baptism did release me in a dear forgiving flood, sprinkling me with Jesus' blood. Satan, hear this proclamation. I am baptized into Christ. Drop your ugly accusation. I am not so soon enticed. Now that to the font I've traveled, all your might has come unraveled. Grace, mercy, and peace be to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. It is a good day to be together. Congratulations. Miles, welcome to the family. It's good to have you, buddy. Yeah, he's raising his arms up. That's great. That's great. There's a different day. Today was a day of lots of expectations, right? You guys, Casey and Angela, you guys have been looking forward to this day, right? Gary and Jean, you guys have been looking forward to this day as well. And the expectations were met with the outcome that was expected, right? Miles got baptized. Though January 14th, 2018 was a different day because so many things that were unexpected started to happen. That was the day when the Minnesota Vikings played the New Orleans Saints. And it was in the... it wasn't the divisional game. It was a wild card game. Yeah, it was a wild card game. But anyways, it was a day of many expectations that weren't expected, things that weren't expected. First off, the Vikings went into halftime being up 17-0, which no Vikings fan ever expects, right? But then, all of a sudden, our expectations started to get met. Soon, the New Orleans Saints scored, and then they scored again, And we scored. But then the Saints scored twice more. And all of a sudden, the score was not in our favor. We were down 23-24. And guess what? There were only 25 seconds left to go in the game. And many melancholy Vikings fans sat there, well, looking forward to their expectations being met with a loss, like always. But then in unexpected fashion, with 25 seconds left to go, a last-second touchdown pass, the only touchdown pass ever to end a playoff game, was scored, and the Minneapolis Miracle was born. Unexpected. Nobody ever thought it would happen for us. The script had been flipped. I still remember it to this day. Many of my friends gathered together in our small, tiny apartment watching the game, surrounded by lots of Packer fans. And we ran out of the room, celebrated and excited. No one knew what we were going to do because no one expected it to happen. Of course, they went on to lose the next game, but whatever. That was expected. But the script had been flipped. Our expectations, all of a sudden, were unexpected. Over time, as we go through life, we develop our own expectations of what will happen, and it can influence how we act in our lives. And not just in football, in things that are much more important than football or sports. And yes, there are many things much more important, like marriage and family and friends and work, serving your neighbors. We have lots of expectations. We even have expectations of God and how He works. Zacchaeus did. Zacchaeus had such low expectations because of the environment that he lived in. Much like a Vikings fan, Zacchaeus didn't expect anything great to happen to him. And because of the environment that he was surrounded in, people ridiculed him, berated him, made fun of him, scorned him, and ignored him because of his work. Now, Zacchaeus isn't a victim of anything. He's not innocent by any means. I mean, he was a defrauder. He was a sinner. But because of his sin, he expected of God so little that when Jesus came through Jericho, the town in which Zacchaeus was in, Zacchaeus wondered to himself, why should Jesus treat him any different? If you want to open up your phones to Luke chapter 19, verse 1, or your pew Bibles that are in front of you, go to Luke chapter 19, verse 1, and you'll find that expectations are littered throughout this reading, Luke 19, verses 1 through 10. You'll even find that Jesus had expectations. And as you try to turn to Luke chapter 19, verses 1 through 10, I want to give you some background. Because in Luke chapter 9, 10 chapters earlier, right at the end of the chapter, Jesus has said that he has set his face toward Jerusalem, meaning that he is a man on a mission. And we know that mission, right? That Jesus was sent down to this world to come down as a man, to take on human flesh, be born of the Virgin Mary, and to go to the cross, to take our sins upon himself and do it willingly. And in doing so, entrust his life to God his Father, so that he might see the outcome of what he expected to happen. So Jesus has set his face toward Jerusalem. He is on a mission to go to the cross, and in light of that, he has the salvation of the whole world in mind. But look at what Luke 19, verse 1 says. It says, Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through. This does not sound like Jesus had a to-do list of people to save, and he was going to Jericho, and he said, when you get to Jericho, make sure that you look up and see the man in the tree, and you call him out, so that he comes down and you can save him. This is not a to-do list of salvation. Jesus has set his face towards Jerusalem, to the cross, for the salvation of the world, but it's in doing so for his mission that he still lives his life on the road for the salvation of people that he meets. Because look at verse 10. Look at verse 10 and what Jesus confirms, that even though there are unexpected things that come, like a man standing up in a tree looking for you, Jesus' expectation is that the Son of Man, as verse 10 says, the Son of Man came to seek and to save what was lost. Our God is a God who saves in unexpected ways and through unexpected means. Jesus just doesn't go to the cross and ignore those who are on the path as he goes down that road. There we see Jesus simply intending to walk through Jerusalem, but he does not ignore those along the way. But everyone else expected him to. I mean, he had lots of fame at this point. That's what Zacchaeus, why he climbed up in the tree. In verse 2, you can see it says that Zacchaeus wanted to know who he was. He wanted to know who this Jesus was. Was this Jesus just someone who would glance by Zacchaeus and pass on by and not care about him and his own sin? Would he treat him just like everyone else did, shun him and close him out? How often, when we come into church, do we expect that Jesus will simply just pass us by? And we climb into the pews, sit from a distance, wondering if Jesus will pass us by. If we'll continue to treat ourselves the same way with sin and doubt and anger at ourselves or other people. Maybe we'll continue to let greed consume ourselves. Maybe we'll continue to ignore those who are on the outskirts, maybe along our line of work or on our travel home. We disregard those who look like they are the neediest. But today is where the shift takes place in our expectations, where we get to behold a new thing, because Jesus, along the way, didn't let Zacchaeus stay up in that tree. Jesus' true expectation is to seek and to save the lost. And it happens even along his journey to the cross and the empty tomb. He intended to pass through Jericho and fulfill his mission, but he never passed up the opportunity to pass on salvation to someone who expected God only to see him as everyone else did, a sinner. So how do you see yourself, and what do you expect of God? How do others see you? What labels have they given you? And what labels do you give yourself? Do you expect God to ignore those or to treat them? See, God gives salvation at unexpected times in unexpected ways. He gives it to a tax collector who looks like a fool up in a tree, who could have more ridicule from other people saying, look at that fool, he can't see him on the ground, so he needs to climb up in a tree. And Jesus climbs up on a tree for Zacchaeus and gives his own life for Zacchaeus, and everyone points and ridicules him, saying, why don't you save yourself? if you're the Son of God. He takes on the foolishness that our sin gives ourselves, and he puts it on his own body. God brings salvation in unexpected times, in unexpected ways, just like he did for Miles this morning. For the unexpected result that the world would look at, that would say, this is just plain water. It can't do anything, and they would be right. They would say, just because you say some nice little words, what does that do? Even though you say in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, what's special about that? It's not in the words. It's not in what comes out of my mouth, but it is in the name of God the Father. That name that was spoken over creation, that was breathed out into creation, that name at which every knee will bow one day, that name by which all people are saved. Even Zacchaeus, even you, even Miles. The unexpected result is that salvation has come here today. Casey, you and Angela and I, we remember we talked a little bit about what people sometimes expect to happen in baptism. And sometimes we talked about how some people say, how can this baby have faith, right? The expectation is that it doesn't change anything. But God works salvation at unexpected times in unexpected ways. This baby today here has salvation and faith. And that faith trusts in that salvation. It came from outside of him. It was spoken to him. We confessed it here together today. And we will continue to remind him of that salvation and faith that he has. The faith always waits for salvation to come to it. When faith will become sight and we will behold Jesus, our salvation, just as Zacchaeus did. Notice Jesus doesn't say, today you have faith. Jesus says in verse 9, if you look at it, today salvation has come to this house. Sinners need salvation. You and I need that salvation. For if we are ever to get out from under the labels, the expectations of other people, if we are ever to escape what we think about ourselves, whether too good or terrible things, it will only be when God comes and says, salvation has come to you, to your life, to your household. We often expect that if God is real, then we need to do something really, really special to make him notice us, to make him and convince him that we do believe. Maybe we think of that one really difficult challenge that we just can't seem to get rid of, that one vice that we can't stop, that one thing that keeps constantly coming back up in our lives, even when we thought it was gone and destroyed and we never go back to it. And we think that maybe if we can just conquer that, Then we'll make God proud. Then he'll really know that we're serious about how much we believe. But that's not how it works, much to our surprise. And thankfully, it's not how it works. Because look at verses 5 and 6 in Luke chapter 19. Jesus is the one who first receives Zacchaeus. He stops and he looks up and he beholds Zacchaeus in that tree. And he says, come down from there. You don't need to be that far off. You can come near to me. In fact, I'll come near to you, to your house, to your life, to be with you in that life. And everyone else is shocked. They say, he goes and he eats with a sinner? See people's expectations? They expect Jesus to ignore sinners and only deal with the righteous. But that's not our God. our God comes for sinners, for Miles and for me and for you. Salvation has come to you. Salvation might seem like a distant hope for some people, and so along your way, you know the end of your mission of faith is to be received into Jesus' kingdom, where you fully get to see it. But as you wait for that mission, think about others' expectations of you as a Christian. What are they expecting from you? Are they expecting that you'll keep them at arm's length and not talk to them about difficult issues? Are they expecting that you won't know how to talk about your faith and so they'll attack you? Are they expecting that you'll attack them? You never know what to expect with a God who does unexpected things. Zacchaeus didn't. Amen. Now may the peace of God, which surpasses all our understanding, keep and guard our hearts and our minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. Please stand as you are able as we confess our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. Together we confess, I believe in one God, Father Almighty. Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Gracious Father, we lift our hearts before you in gratitude for the work you have done, are doing, and will continue to do as our Creator, Redeemer, and Sanctifier. In humble faith, we offer the prayers of our hearts before you, trusting in your mercy to redeem, restore, and renew us by your Holy Spirit. Lord, in your mercy. Gracious God, bless the lands in which we live. Preserve those who continue to work at harvest, making it prosper and flourish. Protect them in their duty. Bless all those who lead and govern us. Fill them with your wisdom. Bless public servants and members of the armed forces, guiding their steps and pathways of peace. Bless all those who serve you by serving their others in their daily vocations. Lord, in your mercy. All-knowing Savior, you know what we need even before we ask. We lift before you, O Lord, the needs of our community. Grant that your presence be known and experienced in the houses and the lives of our families. Comfort those who are homebound or hospitalized or ailing in any way. Especially Pastor Muller, for Kathy Betterman, for Jason Haugen, for Liam and Luca Hausman, for Carl and Beth Hausman, for Dennis Flick, for Jan and Chubb Hensley, for Gene Christensen, for Wayne Hobbin. Pour out your healing mercies, O Lord. We also, Lord, thank you for those who celebrate baptismal birthdays today and grant give you thanks and praise that you have welcomed a new member of Miles into this family. We also give you thanks for Megan Saylor, Ann Madison, Howard Brekowitz, Dominic Meyer, Tate Runge, Aaron Johnson, Tanner Runge, Morgan Johnson, Henry Huntercook, Bethany Jurdy, Jody Barton, Ivy Erickson, Amy Timish, Charles Timish, Nolan Tabert, Lauren Larson, and Lloyd Schwenke. Grant that by their baptisms they may remember the grace that you have given to them in that baptism and the cleansing of new birth. Lord, in your mercy. Into your loving care, O Lord, we commend ourselves and all for whom we pray, trusting in you alone to seek and to save through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. You may be seated. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
Let us pray. Blessed are you, Lord of heaven and earth, for you have had mercy on those whom you have created and sent your only begotten Son into our flesh to bear our sin and be our Savior. With repentant joy, we receive the salvation accomplished for us by the all-availing sacrifice of his blood and body on the cross. To you alone, O Father, be all glory, honor, and worship with the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way also he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the new testament of my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of your sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Amen.
Thank you.
Now may this very body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and preserve you in true faith unto life everlasting. Depart in peace. Today salvation has come to this house. The Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. You may be seated as we sing our closing hymn, A Mighty Fortress is Our God. Thank you all for being here. Welcome to any guests and visitors who are here with us. I know we're going a little bit over, but it's good to be together and spend time in God's Word and rejoice together. And congratulations for Miles again. Here are a few announcements today. We'll go through these quickly. Trunk or treat at 2:30. If you have a car here, if you're bringing a car to pass out candy and show off your awesome costumes, please be here like 1:45-ish, 1:30-ish, around there, so we can be prepped for, we're planning for over 1,000 kids, so that'll be fun. Then right after that, tonight is 6:30, The Chosen. There's a viewing and study going on there here at the church at 6:30 p.m., and then also at 6:30 p.m., there's a Reformation service at Emmanuel in Parker's. Let's see, Wednesday there's Bible class and confirmation. We have Sunday school and Bible class following the service. Sunday school over in the education wing, Bible class in the fellowship hall, so you're welcome to join us on that. And then Thursday next week, 7 p.m., there's a worship service for any deer hunters out at Trinity Lutheran Church in Carlos. So that will be at 7 p.m. Also next week, there's no Sunday school next week. Parents in Sunday school, reminder, we are helping with children's Christmas child shoe boxes and Sunday school offerings for October, and the first couple weeks in November are going to help items for that. Also, LWML is collecting items for Eagles Healing Nest, which is a veterans center in Sauk Center. Lastly, there's information on the table by the office window on what the LCMS is doing to help hurricane victims in Florida and around the world, if you'd like to check out information with that. With that, go in peace and serve the Lord.